Ok, so I met Masaki Kashiwara in 1975, and this is Masaki, Teresa Montero Fernandez, and Pierre Shapira. And at the right, this is Masaki without his glasses, so that's why the photography is fuzzy. So now, so let me say a few words that I met him in 1975 thanks to Pierre Shapira. And for me, Masaki was not only an extraordinary mathematician, but also a deep friend, and with very delicate and sensitive insights about life. And he helped me a lot through a difficult period of my life. And so I thank him. And I worked with him between 75 and, 75, 78. And we worked on the Duflo isomorphism. And we worked also on some other topics that Pierre didn't mention at all. That, but probably it's impossible to give the complete list on problems that Masaki worked on. And so we worked on tensor product of the metaplectic representations. So and it, we discussed complete decomposition of tensor products. And so, okay, what I will talk about is somewhat related to this line of topics. As you said, as it was clear in the last talk, the Duflo isomorphism is very related to the Todd class. And for me, then I want to say something again about the Todd class. And as I hope that I will convince you that the Todd class appears in many different topics. So here are some references. And okay, so the aim of my talk is to discuss multiplicities of representation of a compact Lie group. Multiplicity of representations which are obtained as solution of G-invariant elliptic operators, and to see that this multiplicity have some kind of rigid structure, that they are given by piecewise polynomial function on the dual. And so this, I will construct a piecewise polynomial function from an infinite involving the graded Todd class in equivariant cohomology. And so I will also discuss the relation of this multiplying function with the Noller-Maclaurin formula for the index of the twisted Dirac operator. So the first part of my talk is something which is not at all due to, which is old. But I hope you will see some interest on that. And it's a Riemann-Roch theorem for splines. And so in the second part, I will discuss a multi-spline function associated to a transversal elliptic operator. And on the third part, I will discuss the Noller-Maclaurin formula for the equivariant index. So you have seen this function already many times. So we take this function on the real line, x is a real variable, complex, I mean, and we take the formal series of it, the Taylor series at x equals zero, so it's a formal series, sigma of gamma equals zero to infinity of gamma kxk. So we can act on polynomials because this operator is nil, delta k are nilpotent, so this the action of the series of differential operator of the inverse is well defined on polynomial function on the line. And so similarly, for any integer, you can take the power of this operator and it acts on polynomials. And so what is the space of splines on the line? So I take the definition, which are SM. These are the functions on the line, which are given by polynomial of degree m minus 1 on each open interval. So the end of the interval are at half integer points if m is odd, or at integral points, so it's integral points at, when m is even. So this, and so you are supposed that it is a piecewise polynomial, so on each of this interval is given by a polynomial, and you assume that it of class cm minus 2. And so of course the space of spline is invariant by translation by integers. And there is some particular box splines, which are obtained by the way, by it's called box spline because it's a volume of some slice of a cube, of a hypercube. So these are the box splines, and you can, you look at this function, sine x over 2 over x over 2, and you look at this Fourier transform, and so you obtain a box spline. So there is B1, B2, B3. So B1 is from minus 1/2 to 1/2. So it's continuous at integers, points, B1. And the other one are plainly continuous. So what is numerical analysis about is to approximate a function by some more easy pieces. And so splines were particularly constructed by Bézier to, in fact, they are used a lot. And so the idea is that you give yourself a drawing and you want to reconstruct you want to reconstruct these drawings from the box splines. And so you have the following theorem. Take any element of spline of degree, spline in SM, so spline of degree m minus 1. You define for new an integer in Z, you define this quantity, this number. So again, S is polynomial outside the integers. And so you can differentiate it. Because it's a polynomial, so you can differentiate it with respect to gm minus 1 of delta, and then you take its value at c equals nu. Then it doesn't depend, it's easy to see that it doesn't depend on which left or right limit. You obtain like that a well-defined quantity, p of nu. And the theorem is that then if you S is exactly the is reobtained by, so S is reobtained from the box spline by this formula. So for example, if S is compactly supported, it tells you that any spline function on this class is a finite combination of translate of the box spline, BM. So in some sense, you have this formula, which maybe look like a little bit a Riemann-Roch formula. So P of nu is defined by S with this differential operator. So you have a formula in S, which is this formula. Okay, so let's switch directly to index of transversally elliptic operator. So we consider an elliptic operator on a compact manifold M, Let's consider its principal symbol. So transversal elliptic, so we are, no, sorry, so it's just Irac dot of action. So so we have an elliptic operator, we have its principal symbol, and then the index is, by definition, the dimension with the codimension, and we know that it depends only of the principal symbol of D, so this is the class of the symbol in the K group, topological K group, K0 of T star of M. And we have the Atiyah-Singer formula. So the index of D is the integral over T star of M of the chain character of this element of K0 of T star of M. And this is the Durham cohomology class with compact support on this non-compact manifold N equals T star of M. And then here in the formula, the CI are the chain classes of the complexified tangent bundle to M. Okay, now we have, we consider the same situation, and where now a compact group acts on all the data. And then in this situation, the index is a finite sum of representation of irreducible representation of the group G hat. So we can decompose the index in pieces, and in some sense, sometime I will write also the index of D of G, which is a trace on the kernel minus the trace of the co-kernel, and then you decompose it into characters, irreducible characters of G. And so the I make a simplifying assumption here. I assume that the action of G in M has all the stabilizers of the action are connected. Otherwise, I will have to discuss about not piecewise polynomial functions, but piecewise exponential polynomial function, and I don't want to go on these details. So I will call with this assumption, I can restrict to piecewise polynomials. I don't have to have exponentials in the formula. So under this simplifying assumption, then I will define a canonical piecewise polynomial function on IT star. So the G hat is parameterized by the translate of a lattice in the dual of the Cartan subalgebra. And I will describe a particular function on this lattice in order that you reobtain the multiplicities by just looking at this function at the point of this lattice. In fact, what I did is valid for G connected compactly group, but the proofs reduce to a torus case by some kind of well-known reduction. And so here on this talk, you can think that G is a torus, so G hat is a lattice, the lattice of characters. You can even think that G is S1, and then the lattice of character is Z. So in some sense, it doesn't. So the construction of this piecewise polynomial function is using a Fourier transform of integrals of equivariant cohomology classes. So, yes, so maybe I should say also that transversal elliptic operators are elliptic operators in the direction which are transverse to the orbits. And more or less what I will say will apply to transversal elliptic operators. So we will go back to this later. So we have an equivariant form, which is a differential form on N, which depends of the variable X, which is a variable in G. So we have alpha of x, which is a, so a function from G to A of n, and we have the equivariant differential. And so if you integrate differential, so these forms are usually not homogeneous. So if when I write an integral, that means I integrate the term with the, of top degree. So, and if you integrate this term of top degree, then you have G invariant function on G. And when you can, this is a complex, and if alpha is depends polynomially on X, then the complex care of delta over image of delta, then you obtain a Cartan model for the graded ring of equivariant cohomology of N. And then in this case, if alpha depends polynomially on X, then it's a graded ring with a degree. So we can construct equivariant extension of the classes that we had before. In particular, the graded Todd class. So we had this Todd class, which we can define the graded Todd class. The Todd class, this is as before, but Ci of x is the equivariant chain class. So it's an equivariant extension of the usual chain class, Ci. And but the preceding formula here, x is an element of the Hilly algebra, but the preceding formula is only defined when x is small. And so it is I define the series corresponding to the decomposition of this class in homogeneous classes. So you have a decomposition of this class as an infinite series of cohomology classes which now depend on X on a polynomial way. So they are characteristic classes on equivariant cohomology. And I recall the index formula that I proved with Nicole Berlin, that you have this formula for the trace. And so this is a trace, and so this is like that. And you have the equivariant extension of the chain characters. This is not at all depending polynomially on X. It is e power the curvature of the, so there are some exponential term in CH of sigma. But on the other hand, you, and, and the Todd class is also an infinite series. But this is a well-defined, CH of sigma of X is well-defined for any X. And it's compactly supported in the case of elliptic support, elliptic operators, otherwise. And you have this, this formula for X small. We have the same formula for, what is the interest of this formula? This formula is reduced quite immediately to the Atiyah-Bott Lefschetz formula for compact manifold, but for elliptic operator. But the interest of our formula is that it works exactly the same way when D is transversally elliptic. Transversally elliptic means that it is elliptic only on you assume ellipticity on the direction which is transverse to the orbit. So if your manifold is G cross N, nothing on G and elliptic on N. So, for example, if you have d equals 0 on L2 of S1, but it's transversally elliptic, and the index is L2 of S1 because you take d equals 0, so this is the sum of all the characters, and our formula says something like that, that the sum for all z is equal to this integral, and you see that it's not true, this formula is not true everywhere, but it's true near x equals 0.
What is phi in the formula?
It's integral over S1. This is T star, this is a formula on T star of S1. So T star of S1 is S1 cross R, and our formula is give dxi dphi, the Lebesgue measure, the Liouville measure on T star of S1. And I normalize dphi to be equals to 1. It's an integral over T star of S1. So this formula is obviously false in for x anything, but it's true for x small because both of them are the delta function at zero. So I want to somewhat still get a formula for the multiplicities out of this. I want to decompose the character in irreducible representation. And the method will be to consider Fourier transform of the, of course, I mean, you want to take the Fourier transform of this, I mean, you want to obtain this this Fourier transform. So of course, you want to obtain P nu, of course, you want to do the Fourier transform of the right-hand side. So let's do it. So I have to define what we call with the Concini Processi. We introduce this kind of integrals. So if you have the integral of the chain character of x and against a polynomial function on x, then you obtain a function on the Lie algebra, and you can take the Fourier transform of this function, and then you obtain a distribution. So sometimes I am vague. Sometimes I write distribution with a Dixie, and sometimes without Dixie. So here I write my distribution like S of sigma of alpha of xi Dixie, where my measure Dixie is normalized because there is a lattice everywhere. And in fact, it's not difficult to prove that this distribution, of this function, let's say, this distribution. First, there is a system of hyperplane on G star. G is a torus, so it's not difficult to prove that there is a system of hyperplanes. I will give example later. There is a system of hyperplanes such that this function is locally polynomial outside the system of hyperplanes. So it's given locally by polynomials on open set which are outside an hyperplane, and the distribution involves also derivatives of polynomial functions supported on more and more strata of a system given by a system of hyperplane. But it's again, so it gives locally polynomial functions. And these locally polynomial functions, when you restrict to the open set of this G star H, I think you will see a drawing soon, they vanish when the degree of alpha is very big, greater than dimension of M. So let's do the Fourier transform of this formula. So we have written that as a sum n equals 0 at infinity of tn of x. So let's do the Fourier transform of each term. And so you obtain a formula which is true for x small. So we have this formula for x small. And so this is the right hand side is convergent only for x small. But let's do something very. Very drastic somewhat. You just truncate this series at one point. You truncate it sufficiently high, so you truncate it to the dimension of M. And then you obtain on the right-hand side, you obtain and truncate it and restrict it to G star minus H. So the right hand side, this is a locally polynomial function. So it's rather drastic as a method, but the miracle is that you do this drastic cutting, and you look at this function p tilde which remains, and it extends continuously at each integer, and the value at each integer is p of nu. So somewhat it's like a bad student. You look at this formula, you look at the Fourier transform, and you say, okay, my Fourier transform coincides with what I want, because you have the formula on the right-hand side. So, okay. So, for example, let's come back to L2 of S1. So this was this formula. We had this formula for Z, and this was a formula for the case. And what I said here, which will not impress you, is if you take the function 1, 1, 1, 1, 1, 1, you extend it by 1. Okay. And then you get the formula. But let's do a more amusing example. Let's do the flag manifold. So again, I have produced p tilde, this formula, p tilde. So I do this exercise, verifying the theorem, which is a dangerous exercise. And so you take the flag manifold for U3. You take the line bundle corresponding to 0. So it's a line bundle such that the Dirac operator, if you twist this Dirac operator, the line bundle, then you can compute everything. So the index of DL is a trivial representation. So you obtain the trivial representation as an index, so just a constant function. And so let's look at this subgroup. It's a torus of dimension 2, and I compute the function p tilde for this situation. So this is a function p tilde. And so the z2, so this is, you can see here the hyperplanes I was talking about. So you can see these lines. The lattices have many points, it's z2, but all the vertex of this triangle are elements of the lattice. So on z2, this function must be equal to 0. And accept at 0. So if you compute this function p tilde, but indeed it extends. It is a function which extends the multiplicity. So you may think that to obtain the function, just a Dirac function at 0 to 1, to do that like that is not very economical. But I think it's a very quantum mechanical theorem that, in some sense, particle has to come with a wave. And so I don't know. So here it's somewhat, I feel it's very similar to a quantum mechanical system, that you have a particle, C, and it comes with this little wave. And what about the proofs of this theorem? In fact, the proofs, it's easier to do them with a transversally elliptic operator, because it's easier to deform them. And so you deform them, and then you can use Atiyah theorem for description of, there is a description of the generator of the equivariant K-group of Tg of m, which is a conormal to the orbits. And if you can find generators which are more or less product of operators supported on half lines, And then, more or less, you can apply the Schoenberg theorem. And so somewhat, topologically, it's not so difficult to prove this theorem.
What is Schoenberg theorem?
The one I said before, that you had, you can reconstruct a spline.
Ah, okay, okay, okay.
It's a theorem which tells you something. It tells you that, the theorem is exactly the same than this one, no, that I said before. The theorem is that this is a box spline in two dimension, and it tells you that this is a differentiation of a box spline, and it tells you that it is it restricts to Z2 as a delta function. So you have to prove that this kind of spline restricts to the delta function on the lattice. So, of course, I want to, I have defined the full Todd class. It was an infinite series. And now I want to discuss a little bit of why you need this full Todd class, why it's interesting to have this full Todd class, and the Fourier transform of the full Todd class. And I don't know the meaning of this for general cases, so I will do the, I will restrict to some particular particular cases which are important. So I will talk about the case of Dirac operators. So we have the setting which is compact, oriented, even dimensional spin manifold. So G is a torus acting on the M, and L is an equivariant line bundle on M with a connection. And if you choose an equivariant connection on an equivariant line bundle, you can define what I call anyway a moment map associated to this connection. The curvature, the omega is apart from the factor I, the curvature of the connection, and the Chern class of the connection, and then you define the moment map by the difference between L of X is the action on sections. We have a line, but oh yes, sorry, there is a L and L, so these are not the same letter, so.
This one is for V derivative, I suppose.
Yes, this is a Lie derivative. So I am surprised that Gaber didn't find immediately that I had two L with different meanings. But anyway, so here there is something wrong. This is a curl. This is a Lie derivative action on section of the line bundle, and this is the covariant derivation, and one is covariant derivation. You have to differentiate with respect to an horizontal bundle, horizontal line bundle, and so you have a little part which is vertical, and this is it coincides with a moment map when omega is. When omega itself is not degenerate, so it's a two form, so it can define a symplectic structure, or it can be degenerate from time to time. But if the curvature Laplace of square is non degenerate, this is a moment map in the sense of symplectic geometry. But here I will not take any assumption, so there is no, I don't take any assumption on L of delta, so we can always define a moment map associated to a line bundle with curvature. It's also natural in this case to take power of L and to look at the same formula when you will let the power of L of the line bundle L going to infinity. So you can define the, not only the index of the operator for L, but for all the powers LK, so it's so-called classical limit. And then you quantize this this situation and you obtain an index and you obtain multiplicities which now depend on K. So and more K is big, more this index is large, and so it becomes P of new K. You can always prove that it is supported on the phi of M, the image of M by the moment map, but this will be supported on dilated K phi of M. So it's rather natural to rescale, and if you have a smooth function on G star, you can consider this renormalized sum, the index, and you consider the test function and you put the test function at the lattice divided by k, and you put in front of it the index formula at the point k. So for example, it's a natural quantity because if test equals one, this is just the number, the dimension of your vector space index of Lk, which is a polynomial in k. So I want to say that you can evaluate this quantity either asymptotically, either exactly, using the Todd class. So of course, a particular case of this formula is the classical Euler-Maclaurin formula where all the Bernoulli occur, so it will correspond to the case of P1 with the line bundle L the O of A, and then you obtain this this is Euler-Maclaurin formula that you have I write it here for a polynomial, otherwise it's an asymptotic series if you divide it by test, if you divide test k, if you divide it by I over k. So this is a formula where all the Bernoulli, so you have the integral, the value at the endpoint of the interval, and then the series, but which is finite when test is a polynomial, involving the Bernoulli number at the endpoint. So the theorem is somewhat the same here, is that for any infinity function on G star, then this series is admits an asymptotic expansion when k goes to infinity, and this asymptotic expansion can be computed. I will give a formula for this asymptotic expansion. So let's I want to describe the distribution DHN. I start by DH0. So we have associated to the line bundle L, I had the omega, which was a two-form, and phi of x, which was a moment map. And it's very easy to see that if you do this, the sum of this function, degree zero, plus form of degree two. This is an equivalent closed form of degree two. Hein. I recall that x is graded of degree two, so this is linear in x, so it's degree two in the equivalent, it's a function, but depending on x linearly, so it's an element of degree 2, and omega is a form of degree 2. So, and it's closed just because of the Bianchi identity. And so you can consider this integral, which is the equivariant volume. You integrate that, and so by definition, you see that it is, so you, is the integral of phi of m of x, which is the moment map, the component of the moment map related to x, and e power I omega, which is a form. And as I said, you integrate only the top term. The top term is, you have to take dimension of m over 2, so integrate the top term. And if you integrate the top term, then you obtain by phi goes to g star. So this is just the push forward of this measure of this density. So like that, you obtain a sign measure which is supported on a union of polytops, and in fact, which depends only of your L. It doesn't depend on the choice of phi and omega. So it's a canonical, measure, locally polynomial, and it's locally polynomial. This is the same theorem than Duisternat's theorem, Duisternat-Ekman theorem. You obtain something which is locally polynomial. I recall this beautiful theorem of Duisternat-Ekman that in the symplectic case, if you do the push forward of the Liouville measure by the moment map in the case of torus action on a symplectic manifold, then you obtain a locally polynomial measure supported on phi of m, and this is a convex polytop. So, but somewhat more or less the same proof gives you that in general, in this situation, then you obtain a sign measure supported on a union, which is not supported anymore on a convex polytop, and there is some plus and minus, and you obtain a sign measure supported in a union of polytops and locally polynomial. So you can do now I define this, I have to define this DHN. So I do the, in the equivalent cohomology, I take the square root of the third class. You can do it formally, so you obtain a series. And before I was doing for general elliptic operator, so I was working on T star of M, and here somewhat I do the Dirac operator and I work on M. So somewhat the square root of the third class appears. So we have, then we can define this series, and again it has, you can expand it in infinite series, and you can define the Fourier transform of this equivalent classes, is what we call with the infinitesimal index when with the Concini processi, you do the Fourier transform of this each of the term of this series, so you obtain again distribution, but here you have a distribution which are supported on depend of the n. When n is small, it's for n equals zero, you obtain a measure, then differentiation of a measure which can be again locally polynomial, but then more and more you go, more and more derivative you obtain, and finally you obtain something singular and supported on hyperplanes. But still, this is a formula. When k goes to infinity and test is a function on g star, then this series is asymptotic to this series of distribution. So I think it's a formula which resembles very much formula which were which are well known in the case of polytops, but that you will have the number of points in a polytops, or weighted number of points is polytops, like the Erard polynomial or something like that. Then you obtain this number of points, or weighted number of points, you obtain it as an integral, plus a certain number of derivatives of this function on different faces. So this is a theorem which is true for any Dirac operator. And so this is the formula that... what I didn't discuss, but that we can do, of course, is when we have a non-compact manifold M, but the line bundle with a proper moment map. And so somewhat you see that the definition of the... the definition of these things, in fact, requires only that the function phi is proper. So you can define more generally. You can define more generally this expansion for any manifold M with proper moment map. And you can prove that what you obtain is functorial with respect to restrictions. So this is something. Okay, so happy birthday. And I hope that maybe we will have to collaborate more some later on some other subject.
Question or remarks?
Is it possible to speak about higher, like finer than asymptotic series? Like in physics, there are sometimes exponential terms times another series. Does anything like this appear here?
So what do you want to do? You want to do other you want to do asymptotic with respect to what? Some similar parameter?
Yes. Does it appear at all? So like some exponential times asymptotics, time a series, time another exponential times another power series.
At least what I feel is that certainly you should also introduce the parameter, the line bundle as a parameter. Here I have to introduce only.
Yes.
One power, certainly, the asymptotic okay. Should be on all the Picard group. But, probably. But it's a little bit complicated because then you don't know which direction. Anyway, so I didn't do it. No.
Other questions? Okay, so let's thank the speaker again.